So I've been a Series 3 Land Rover owner for some years now. I bought this vehicle, this 109, in 2013, and I didn't really know what I was buying at the time or quite what I'd let myself in for. And I thought it's about time that I did something of a buyer's guide, hopefully to help one or two people avoid the mistakes that I made, and just generally, you know, point out a few of the common problem areas. These vehicles were made from 1971 to 1985, so the youngest are now 35 years old, so there are a few trouble spots. So as you can see in the handbook, there are quite a variety of body styles for the short wheelbase and long wheelbase. This is by no means comprehensive. There are other special versions like the high capacity pickup, but it gives some idea of the variety available. Certainly one of the most desirable are the 109 station wagons and the 88 station wagons. Probably the best looking are the truck cab 88s, but that's just my opinion. You'll find short wheelbases are more sought after than long wheelbase. They're a little bit easier to live with, especially if you live in a built up area. 109s can be quite hard to park, and you can go around a multi-story. I've done it with mine, but it is hard work. So obviously this vehicle is a 109, and there are some differences between this and an 88, but in this video we should cover the basics of what you need to look for. So a quick wander around the vehicle. The Series 3's differed from the Series 2's mainly in appearance. There's not a huge difference, but there are some under the skin, like the gearboxes, the clutch arrangement, and there was a gradual change over the late 2A and into Series 3 production. But the lights moved out to the wings. It's not uncommon to see Series 3s fitted with a 2A front slam panel. It's quite easy to make a later vehicle look older and vice versa, so that's something to look out for. This one's an ex-military vehicle, but standard. It's a civilian spec body and chassis. Your main enemy with a Series Land Rover is rust. There's actually quite a lot of steelwork in one of these vehicles, despite the aluminium bodywork. Typical rust spots are the bottom of the front slam panel. This is a good example at the moment. This vehicle does need some further restoration work, so you can see a bit of rot creeping in. So that's somewhere to look. Chassis, they're very prone to rot. As I say, the youngest of these vehicles are now 35 years old. This one is now fortunately on a galvanised chassis, but it was quite bad. Typically the outriggers fail. The most important place to look first is up under here. Look at the end of this outrigger and then come and have a look at the bulkhead foot. It's really important that's in good condition. Now the sill bracket is tucked up in there behind the foot, and they often rot out of sight, so it's very important to have a look. Very common to find Series Land Rovers with holes here and around the hinges and further up the bulkhead, typically in this area here. But the whole bulkhead is steel, none of it's galvanised, and there's plenty of water traps. Similarly, you want to have a look inside, and the bulkhead and footwells should be in really good condition. It's not uncommon at all to find holes down in that corner, or very badly patched or plated over footwells, and they are part of the structure, so they're quite important. 109s tend to suffer up the back of the chassis, particularly just in this area here, the bottom of these chassis legs. You'll find them often rotted out and plated, which is pretty bad news around the spring hangers. There's quite a lot of outriggers on the chassis, and they're all prone to rot. Rear cross member is another real rot spot, because it's such a mud trap. There's lots of steel work in the bodywork. So this strap here, for example, is steel, not galvanised. And under the floor, the tub floor, there are these supports. Now the body tub and all the body work is Bermabrite, which is an aluminium alloy, and we'll go around the other side because it's easy to see. But anywhere that Bermabrite meets steel, you can expect rot. So if we come under here, you can see where the tub attaches to the chassis,
and it's very common for the tub to rot out against the chassis. The two metals react, so you want to be prepared to get under the vehicle and have a really, really good route around. Be aware of fresh underseal, and generally have a very, very careful look at it.
Well, most you should find the chassis number on the dom iron there. It's elsewhere on the chassis as it's a replacement, but that's the standard position, just above that bracket that's welded on for the front spring hanger, or just on it if I remember rightly actually. That's a common rot spot, and it's quite common to find that that dom iron has been cut off and replaced. So if it's not there, certainly on later series 3s, you will find the chassis number on the bulkhead. The doors are another rot spot. Typically the drain channels in the door tops block up and they rot out. The door frame is steel clad in aluminium, or the door top frame I should say, and the door itself, the frame is steel made out of sort of pressed box sections. This one's gone a little rusty now. It was repaired some years ago. The whole bottom section was replaced because it was rotted out. It's absolutely not unusual, so you want to have a good check under there. It's not the end of the world. You can get new door frames and it's fairly easily repaired, but it is something to look out for. Again, you get more corrosion between steel and aluminium there. This vehicle is actually needing a little bit of repair now in the spring. There's a bit of rot creeping in at the bottom of the and the edge of the footwell on this side, and water ingress is a problem in these vehicles. The drain channels tend to block up, and you find that the seals tend to leak a little bit because, frankly, these vehicles are designed to be taken apart, so it's difficult to get really good seals. This one's pretty good, but you can see what the water ingress has done there. Again, the back door is a typical rot spot. You'll find around the bottom of the door frame, very common to find rot. Well worth having a good look at the tub floor. This one's reasonable, but I think it wants a bit of TLC in the spring, a bit of paint, perhaps some of the corrosion treating and so on. But it's not unusual to find that they've had plates riveted over, that sort of thing. As I mentioned, there are supports underneath the tub, so again, more steel against aluminium. It's also really important to check the rear crossmember tub mounts. Again, the bodywork can rot out around those, and you've then got a nice little repair job to do. Rear cross members are a typical rust trap box section. The mud gets inside and it just rots them out. So
if you have got a galvanised chassis, or if you do find a vehicle with a galvanised chassis, it's well worth just paying a little more for it, in my opinion.
So in the 109, the load area is quite generous. The wheel arches are somewhat an intrusion, but they allow you to mount seats as originally. Station wagons are a little different. There's a bit more steelwork in those, and the rear floor is different. This isn't the tidiest of examples, but there's really not an awful lot to say about it. Often a toolbox in here, sometimes a spare wheel mount the other side. There are a great many options. So just have a good look at the floor and make sure it's not rotten. It is part of the tub and integral to its strength. So this Series 3 is a fairly honest, well-used example, but maintained. Under the bonnet it has the 2¼ petrol engine, the later 5 main bearing. These can be identified by their
terracotta red paint.
And on the head, this one, being a later metric head, has HRC 1303. You find that quite a lot of small differences crept in with the engines, but the basic block design is similar. The earlier three main bearing engines were often painted a sort of greeny duck egg blue. Not a great deal to say about it really, other than they are generally nice reliable units if well maintained. Probably underpowered for the size of the vehicle, but that makes them low stressed. And they can be really quite pleasant, these petrol engines. The diesel engines, you need to keep an eye on the timing. The timing change can stretch and they get very, very lethargic then. The diesel is certainly much noisier than the petrol. A well-tuned petrol should be a real joy to drive, and I certainly will not be changing mine out for a TDI anytime soon. Not if I can help it. This one has a SU conversion. It originally had a Zenith carburetor. This setup just gives a little more power, and there are various things you can do, like you can have head skimmed, gas flowed, tubular manifolds, performance camshafts, that kind of thing. But about 120 horsepower is probably about the limit for one of these engines. As this one is, I reckon it's around 75-80. It's probably a little underpowered for the size of the vehicle, but they are very sweet engines. Really, you should just check the condition of the oil, the coolant, look for any leaks. It shouldn't belch smoke when you take the oil filler cap off, so you shouldn't see it breathing excessively. It should be easy to start. Starter motors are often lazy on these engines, and that's usually down to a poor earth. So if it cranks over nicely, generally a sign of good maintenance. As you can see, this vehicle has a servo. Not all Series 3s did, but it's certainly a worthwhile addition, and I believe you can convert to the servo if you don't have one. The later Series 3s, like this one, had twin leading shoe brake system. So on the back plate you'll find two adjusters.
Should have a good brake pedal. So again, that's a good sign of maintenance. If it doesn't have a good pedal, it probably hasn't been adjusted recently.
So whilst under the vehicle,
check the condition of the front swivels. It's very common to find the swivel units badly pitted and leaking oil, and they really shouldn't be. I would at this point advise taking a friend with you when you go to view a vehicle and have someone work the steering while you look underneath the vehicle. And you shouldn't see excessive play at the swivels or in the ball joints.
Land Rovers are often neglected in this area. You can just see the steering relay up there. They can be a real pain to get out of an original chassis. So it's a good check to see that that's in good condition. Again, you want to look for rusty springs. If the springs are nice and oily, it's another sign of maintenance. They shouldn't be blown out with rust. And the dampers shouldn't be, or shock absorbers shouldn't be leaking oil.
So the axle we've just seen on the front is a Rover axle. The Series 3 long wheelbase has a Salisbury axle as standard on the rear, which is a very good thing to have. It's not unusual to find rotten fuel tanks.
And again, you can see the Salisbury axle.
Have some idea of what it looks like. So check the condition of the fuel tank. They often rot out between the
sort of armoured skin and the tank itself.
So this is a rear fuel tank. Some vehicles have under-seat fuel tanks, particularly military ones,
and 88s. So this vehicle is quite standard inside. The equipment as standard is pretty basic. You get a heater, in this case two-speed wipers, and that's about it really. Everything should work. They are so simple, there's no excuse for things that don't work. Later Series 3s have hazard warning lights and a center binnacle. You can just see a warning lamp fitting that little rectangle, and that's a brake fail light. So that's something else to look out for on the later series vehicles. The shuttle valve in the brake system can give trouble. This vehicle is equipped with sound deadening, but very often there'll be nothing on the floor, so you can have a really good look at the condition. Have a look up underside of the bulkhead. It shouldn't be seriously rusty because the
pedal boxes mount there, as does the steering box. Not a lot of room in one of these, so if you're over 6 foot, you might struggle. So from the passenger side, typical rot spots. The windscreen wiper motor cover tends to rot out, and I fabricated a new one some years ago. It still needs recovering properly. Dashboards also rot out, so it's a good idea to have a little push along there and just see that it's not totally rotten and that there isn't rust all falling out. The gearboxes in these vehicles are well known for leaking. It shouldn't be excessively leaky, but particularly have a look around the back of the handbrake drum. It's very common for oil to be leaking from there if the seal is in poor condition. So when you test drive one of these vehicles, it's a good idea to thoroughly test the condition of the transmission. Four-wheel drive in high range is activated by pressing the yellow knob down, and it's disengaged by pulling the red lever back and then pushing it back to the bulkhead, and the yellow knob should pop up again. You may have to drive a short distance to get it to thoroughly or properly disengage, but it's a good idea to check these. Low range four-wheel drive, simply pull the red lever back. If the vehicle has three-wheel hubs, engage them before you do this. There are a great many options you can have on these vehicles. There were fairy overdrives as standard on some vehicles from the factory, or as a factory option, I should say. Say the late County models, which are about 1982, I think they came along. This one has a Roma drive, which is aftermarket, and if you've gone to look at a vehicle and it has one of these, it's a definite plus point, I would say. The steering should not be unnecessarily vague, and there will be some play. Before we set off on a drive, I'll try and show you. There usually is a very small amount of play because of the type of steering box it has. It's a Wurman recirculating ball steering box. And also, these vehicles are on live axles, of course, so there's the movement of the axle relative to the chassis, which of course has the fixed steering relay. So it won't drive like a hatchback, and if you've been driving, say, a brand new Golf every day and you're thinking of getting rid of it for one of these, I'd just hang on to the Golf until you're sure. They're not the easiest of things to drive, but certainly full of character and a very great deal of fun. So the vehicle should start straight up from hot. You might find with the Zenith carb it's not quite so keen. That is a common fault in hot weather, and it just needs a bit more cranking. Certainly from cold, should go straight away. And settle to a nice healthy tick over. It's a good idea at this point just to put your foot on the clutch, depress the clutch, and listen for any whirring, which is a good sign that the clutch bearing's on its way. This one's nice and quiet. Right, let's go for a drive. These vehicles are really quite underpowered. If you have an overdrive, it makes an excellent stepper gear, which is what I'm doing now. Plenty of cyclists around today. Thank you. pause between third and fourth. You don't want to rush the changes. You'll find on earlier boxes the synchro on second gear tends to be a little weak. I believe they rectified this for the later ones. Cruising along in overdrive top, it should be pretty quiet. Shouldn't be bangs and rattles. You can expect some bangs and clunks when you put your foot on and off the accelerator or demonstrate. Just the nature of the transmission. There's a lot of backlash in the gears on one of these, but the noise should not be excessive. But generally when driving sensibly, it should not bang and clunk taking up drive. We shouldn't wander all over the road, but it is live axle, so it will give a bit of feedback.
One of these well laden can be well over 2 tons, so
that getting on the way for 3 tonnes, I think it is. So we'll work from this goes.
So, just to give some sort of idea of maintenance costs, the handbook suggests that the transmission oil should be changed every 24,000 miles. I change mine every 6, and it's usually still quite clean when changed, but I feel it's something that's important to do if you run an overdrive, particularly a Roma drive, which shares the transfer box oil. Having also rebuilt my transmission, that's personal choice, just looking after it. But I would certainly recommend that you change it at least every 12,000 miles. If you're wading one of these vehicles, water tends to get into the transmission units, the swivel units particularly. So it's worth considering if you're looking for a vehicle to go playing in the mud every weekend. Your maintenance costs are going to be an awful lot higher. Recommended change for the engine oil is 6,000 miles. I change mine every 3, and I find in winter that's enough. It's getting dirty by then and it wants changing. In the summer you could probably let it go longer, but that's my recommendation anyway. 3,000 miles engine, 6,000 miles for the rest of the transmission. So there we are. I hope that's something of a guide to buying a Series 3 Land Rover and what you should look for and be aware of. There's probably a multitude of things I've missed, and you should be aware that these vehicles had a multitude of changes over the years, and often owners have changed things. You know, there's lots to watch out for, but that was a sort of basic guide, I suppose. All I'll say is that I've greatly enjoyed owning this vehicle over the years I've had it, and I hope to continue enjoying it for many years to come. The social side of Land Rovers is great. There's a lot more to owning one of these than just driving and maintaining it. So make sure if you buy one, you get involved in some events. Great fun. Anyway, like I say, hope the video has been useful, and thank you for watching.